going to start off the next 80 years by cutting the cake.
My pleasure.
I'll make a very precise decision.
I'd like to invite you to join us together. We've asked the folks here if they might not be inclined to share with us a story or a memory, anything that has to do with any of those 80 years that various people in this room at various times have been able to enjoy. And so before you get to speak, we're going to speak.
All right.
So I'd like to invite you to take your throne over there.
You don't have to make any lengthy speeches.
Well,
I
can respond with a few
of
yeah,
you can. Front row seats here, please.
This is in no particular order except as a kind of general crescendo towards immediate family. And at the outset, I should say that although we are here to celebrate this milestone of my father's coming to his 80th birthday, it's not the only person here who is in a position to celebrate such a milestone. So Marjorie Farrar is also recently passed into the blessed state of octogenarianhood, and we have equally high congratulations for this milestone, too.
Yay.
I believe you have some memories for us of Father. We would love to hear.
I can tell you about...
Can you all hear?
I can tell you about two times that Henry has really hit the mark. The first time that I remember is one summer when he had just graduated from high school and I had just graduated from high school. He came and spent part of the summer with us up in Maine on a lake called Sisla Dobsa Sis. And we lived in a little cabin. And every morning Henry would go out and take my wet knitted bathing suit off the line and throw it over the partition. And every time it would hit me right in the face. And that would get me up and we would go swimming. So the next, after many other interesting and pleasant circumstances, the next time when he hit the mark, he came to see my mother, who was really beginning to fail quite badly. And he said, "Why don't you try a certain medicine?" Which we tried, and in 2 weeks, the nurse that was taking care of her said, "It's a miracle." And she really got along beautifully from then on.
And for many years, too.
For many years,
how
yes.
many?
Oh, maybe 10 more or 15 more years.
All right.
And Henry did that for us.
That's a good testimonial.
I have a little story. Which is another tale of just how wonderful Cousin Henry was to me. When I moved here with my husband from New York in 1967, he invited us to participate in the Mechanics Institute. I found out that not only was my cousin a doctor and participating in that part of the world, but he was making a wonderful contribution helping the Mechanics Institute to run and to be a wonderful place, and I was allowed to join, and I used to use it when I worked downtown. It was a great place to be able to go, so I always appreciated that. It was such a warm welcome that he made for us when we first moved here, and I really thought it was wonderfully nice.
Tell us about the Mechanics Institute. What's the Mechanics Institute?
The Mechanics Institute is a There's a library in downtown San Francisco that was formed, and you'll have to tell the story, not I, in the 1880s or 90s. 1880s probably, for mechanics. 1868, much older than I thought. And it's a library that's a private library, and basically it has a good collection, and it's available to people to go in and read. A wonderful chess club, right?
Can I add to the testimony? I once wanted to find a 1920 issue of the National Geographic, and that's where I found it.
The Farrars are well represented here today. Would you like to add to this?
Only I do want to say that some of us are going back to Farrars. And others are not.
she's the one who has to be conservative.
I had a Cajun which isn't particularly relevant to space anecdote to be around Pacific Medical Center in 1979-1980. And it was then that I discovered, because I had some friends on the nursing staff, how well Henry is beloved at the Pacific Medical Center, which of course is so nice because of the history of the Gibbons family with the Pacific Medical Center. Well known and well loved.
Some of the persons who would like to have been here today were not able, and I have a few letters that I will read from time to time. And we have greetings from Suzanne Schinkel and a nice letter from John Schinkel with a reminiscence that goes back a rather long way. First, let me congratulate you on your 80th birthday. This is a little later than the actual date, but I hope it's timely for the party. I'm sorry we can't be there in person, but Peg and I should still like to add our voices to the celebration. I guess an 80th birthday is a pretty good time to reminisce, so I'll indulge myself and go back some 64 years, back to the summer you spent with us in Maine. I was entirely an Eastern cousin at that time, and it was the first time we had seen you in the East. It was an enjoyable summer, which I'll always remember clearly. My brother Ed was away, and although you were a bit older, accentuated by the ages of 10 and 16, we were together a lot. Two things stand out in my memory of that summer. The first was in connection with learning to handle a canoe. One without, and I can't read this, really delicate, in any case, to keep upright. You may remember that you and I had one out on a fairly large lake in a pretty good wind, both high up on the seats so that the center of gravity was too high, when it tipped over. Luckily, everything in the canoe floated, so we swam around and collected seats and paddles and managed to get the canoe ashore, full of water, but not of boys. We weren't proud of that adventure, but I guess we learned from it because it didn't happen again. Well, it did, but more about that later. The other memory I'm sure you do not recollect, you had apparently just finished a course in physics. You used to explain some of the marvels learned in that course. One thing you taught me was the acronym VIBGIOR. Do you remember the acronym VIBGIOR? V-I-B-G-Y-O-R. It is pronounceable as a word, and the letters are the first letters of the colors in the visible spectrum. Violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. It's useful to remember the correct order of the colors. It may be more than coincidence that the visible spectrum and its variations is a central factor in optical mineralogy, which has become an absorbing hobby for me. Henry, it's a pleasure to think back over these times and things, and there are many more I've not written down. My best wishes are with you, and may you have many more such birthdays. Your cousin, John Schinkel.
All right.
David Faraday, do you have something to share with us?
I thought about it, and most of my memories about Henry are in Huntington Lake, and more generalities, but I only think of a bunch of having a fishing pole in one hand and a hammer and a saw in the other, you know, with saggy pants.
And floppy hats.
Don't you remember the chess game by telephone, by mail that we had together?
Well, that was Michael, I believe. That was Michael.
Yeah, you were David.
I was David, right.
Michael, I understand you have a production for us. I think it's about time for a...
With a very small production.
All right.
I'm going to play two parts. The obvious one of the parts, and the other one is at the end will be as a narrator. So we'll summarize the skits at the end, okay?
Henry Gibbons.
Coming, Mother.
Have you done your chores today?
Yes, Mother, but...
But what, Henry?
But I didn't get my allowance this week.
Yes, I know. Go see your dad.
But he said to see you.
Well, I guess you'll just have to develop more patience, Henry.
Okay, Mom. Okay, Mom, anything you say. Now I'm a narrator. And he did, and his medical patience will be forever grateful.
Toby!
It's pretty well established that we go back many years and you're very young, why the age differential is more acute. And I'm going back a lot farther than others. You all I know about Huntington Lake, but not very many of you know about Salmon Lake. Two or three do in person, others by just having heard of it. Well, I actually, here's a picture of Salmon Lake. We can pass it around.
Yeah, I'm sure that's a candidate.
That's one of the Gibbons mansions at Salmon Lake. One room, wasn't it? It did have a budget. But getting to Salmon Lake, if you don't know where it is, if you go through Downeyville and Sierraville and up over to the mountains and it's very rugged country, and in those days, we're talking approximately 1920. My facts may be slightly wrong, but the principle is here. So if Henry was 14 and I was 8, why, Henry was like a legend in his own time. I mean, after all, he showed me around the place. He showed me the stamp mill that they had up there to bring up the course. He may have taught me how to row a boat, because you had to row across Salmon Lake to get from where Bart was parked over to the living area. But the main thing that impressed me was that Henry swam the full length of Salmon Lake, and I think I'll never forget how impressed I was with that feat. So there is my contribution.
Yay!
I have another letter here from Liz Van Ingen, who is with her family in Arizona somewhere and was unfortunately unable to be here today. But she has some fond memories and would like to share them with us. How could I be such a fortunate little girl as to have an Uncle Henry? Why, that put me in a class with Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz. With a real, live Uncle Henry, I could play and imagine just like Dorothy. That put Uncle Henry in a very special place in my life. Katie and I, as children, were fishing in a stream someplace, watching the fish jumping all over the place. So many fish! Why weren't we catching any? Why? Because it was Uncle Henry behind us, skipping stones across the water. The bonus was that he taught us how to find flat rocks and skip them too. This is an invaluable talent to possess in later years, as one can show off for one's children. Uncle Henry and my father visited us in Iowa 10 years ago when we lived in a farmhouse way out in the middle of the cornfields. I enjoyed having him and sharing my Van Ingen family with my Gibbons family. It was also a pleasure to see the brothers, Henry and Walter, enjoying time together. Uncle Henry is a constant and assuring person in my family, and I wish him a happy 80th birthday and many, many more happy, healthy years. Tony sends sincere greetings with mine as to Carolyn, Linda, and Mary Ann. Katie, do you have something to add to that?
A lot of us talk about Uncle Henry at Huntington Lake because that's where we do spend time together, even though we all live in a much close area here in the Bay Area. But I remember one time at Huntington Lake, if you know where the cabins are, you can look across the lake and there is a green meadow. And the meadow seems to be getting smaller, but it's only that the trees are getting taller and you can't see so much of the meadow, but it remains green as it has all of my life. One time, Uncle Henry, for some reason, I was up there either alone or he took me specially over to that meadow, and he took me in a boat and we hiked up there for a picnic and at the meadow, and there's a stream going through it, which of course creates the meadow. We drank the water out of the stream, which was the most delicious water I have ever had. I'll never forget how wonderful it was. And my fondest memory is that I had that special one-to-one day with Uncle Henry.
That meadow is still there.
Still there.
Do you have
something? You must have.
His immediate family loves him, his relatives all love him, and I know because I've heard them say it that his patients love him. This is a little different. At Henry's mountain cabin, there are bears who nightly add a burden to our care. They eat our daily garbage with delight. When raiding garbage cans, they're very bright. And many fine inventions have been thwarted in spite of all the boastful plans reported. Mm-hmm. The bear sits down astride the garbage can. The lid pops off in spite of every plan to stop his grim marauding. He walks away amidst all trash and tins in disarray. The garbage can is bent, the cover mangled, the nerves of cabin owners jangled. But Henry said, "There, there, I'll fool that bear." He found a handy rope that he could spare, and tied the heavy garbage to it. Then using all his common sense and wit and vigor, where am I? He threw the other end around the limb and lifted up the garbage can with vim and vigor. He tied it up beyond the claws of any bear. But oh, alas, a pause, and then the branch broke off. The can let go on Henry, feeling jubilant glow. It crashed on Henry's unsuspecting head. Oh, pshaw, said Henry. I should have given him some sleeping pills instead. Then Henry bought some pepper from the store and sprinkled many grains, and every day some more, to keep the bears away. His family said, achoo, when dumping garbage in the can, and so would you. The bear came back again. He wouldn't stop. He grew quite fond of pepper on his slop.
Pepper cooked for a while.
Henry, I'm not sure it's exact anyway, but.
We're going to get a little closer to home now, and I'd like to ask Pete and Louise Walker if they might share some memories of your father.
I can lock us off of this, and I thought, gee, maybe I could write up some witty rhyme. Who could top that anyway? But I.
That's my wheezy.
There are so many things that pass through my mind, but I think overwhelmingly, if I can get through this without crying, it would be a miracle. Dad has been a real inspiration to me throughout my life. I don't think I've ever known anything as determined or as high integrity and a great example in the quality of life that he lives for himself as well as for the people that he comes in touch with. And I the only thing I find that's hard about that is I tend to want to expect the same in other people. And it's really hard to find all that wrapped into one. But on the fun side, I think the memories that I cherish the most of you, Dad, are the times we played tennis together. He taught me, boy, if any of you know, I'm very avid a tennis player now, and I'm playing competitively like I've never played before. It's an awesome sport. and all the games that we played throughout the years, dog nose, cribbage, Scrabble, real mastermind here. But it's been a real blessing in my life to have it. And I praise God for that.
Through the whole process again, and he'd move another couple of feet, and that's how they crossed that stream.
Okay, Jim told you that,
No, I was there.
I'm sure you put his nose under the water, and he couldn't breathe, so he had to do something when you had to move his feet.
He put his nose
under
the water.
Alice, at the risk, knowing that you are still living in the close proximity to the gentleman here, at a considerable risk to yourself, I realize, but perhaps you have a wonderful story for
you. I'm careful what you say.
Well, I still like Daddy. I do want to say, and I do get to hold the camp of crybabies. I want to acknowledge you, Daddy, for being so wonderful to your children, letting us pursue our visions like being musicians and artists and housewives and tennis players. And community-minded people. Our sense of community is very, very strong in Gibbons family and is still bringing forth in our particular regions. And I really want to acknowledge Mom, you and Dad are both, you know, have been so strong and natural, spontaneous in this way of action and being that I just fall through. And also my favorite memories of my dad are still going on is this crazy whimsicalness that you get sometimes. Like one time, I didn't see this, but I remember it was only like this garbage day on Pacific Avenue. They used to have these trucks rolling this garbage, so she goes in the spinning and comes out and just dumps it and says, "Good morning," to the garbage.
Hi.
And you know, he just does real spontaneous things like that. And, I don't know, he's not very good.
unpredictable, and I really enjoy that in my life myself. You said it's a good bedrock of my creativity. So thanks, Dad.
Wonder how many garbage bags people come out.
You're one of the joys of having healthy parents who are thriving in their older age, especially if we have two sets of them, and they get along well together, as the Wallens and the Gibbonses most certainly do, is that we have a lot to share across the in-law side, too. And Jackie has brought something from the Wallen side that we'd like to share.
This is a tape from my sister. We'll have to pretend we have champagne glasses in hands, since it didn't seem possible to do it before. So this is a word directly from my sister on behalf of all of the Wallens who have enjoyed very much their association with Papa G and all the Gibbons.
Is that from Penny?
This is for Penny.
Leprous look
stay neath my gown, deep neath the yards of white. A lovely bride for Henry's son, and not an awful fright. But underneath that wedding hush, our secret memory, a swollen hip, a frump, a blush, Jackie and Papa Jean.
Turns out, I thought I was sitting up early. I'll go back to the previous evening. I showed up late in the evening, and dinner was there waiting, and we sat down by the fire afterwards, and Uncle Henry wanted to play a little game of dominoes before retiring, and I thought, well, sure, I've played dominoes quite a bit. I hold my own. And Aunt Virginia was off doing the dishes and cleaning up, and came to sit down by the fire. And I had managed to go about halfway around the board and was heading for home, and Uncle Henry was about ten pegs up. And I was about three quarters of the way finished, and he still was about a quarter of the way. And I was thinking to myself, now, I've got a couple of choices here. I could really take it slow, or I could really move in for the kill. And before I knew it, Uncle Henry had passed me, and it was neck and neck, and I was really fighting for my life. And as it turns out, he did beat me. And I was completely shocked. I didn't know what had happened. It was in a span of about 5 minutes. So I realized that you weren't just holding back. Just had to get warmed up. Another thing that I had was I went up the previous year with a friend of mine named Kurt, who was my roommate, and we were closing the cabin, putting the cans on the chimney, and Uncle Henry said, well, you know, don't worry about that, I'll go ahead and do it, and this is climbing up, you know, a ladder, and then you have to hoist another ladder up over the roof line and climb up that, and I don't know too many 80-year-olds that can do that. I mean, it's just... It's a very agile thing, and he was more than willing to do it, but Kurt went up there and risked his life and said, God, you know, what would they do without us? I said, oh, he'd go up and do it. I mean, it's just, it wouldn't matter.
No more.
And another thing was that this year, after playing the dominoes, went to bed, and I'm a fairly early riser, and I got up at sunrise. But I guess sunrise came a little earlier on your end of the cabin because it was about 6 o'clock in the morning and Aunt Virginia was up making breakfast and doing chores and Uncle Henry was out there putting the what kind of coating, linseed oil, on the deck. And honest to God, it was about 38 degrees outside. He's down there on his knees just slopping away, fixing that stuff up. But just the energy, again, the things that people have said previously, the lust for life, the ability to just get up and enjoy what you're doing, it's a tremendous example, I think, for all of us here, and something that I certainly appreciate. And I think Aunt Virginia might have put it best. We were having our lunch of hot dogs and potato chips sitting around the table in the sun on the porch looking out over Huntington Lake, and I said, God, where does he get all this energy? And Aunt Virginia said, well, I really don't know, but I know he's got a lot of Uncle Wiggily in him. I think I said something like, well, when do you see this? And she said, you know, how often do you see it? I mean, is he like this all the time? She said, all the time, every single day. And I just think that's tremendous. I think it's an incredible credit.
Chip, you're my boy.
you were so pulled over by Louise's presentation that we skipped all over Pete, but that's unfair. Pete, would you
You can't skip over people.
We just are not going to do it.
No. Anyway.
Oh, yeah.
There's no magic tricks today. Last time I was up before everybody, but octogenarians, thinking back, looking at the pictures out there, reminded me of where I, like Jackie, I needed some medical assistance. Elise and I were out for a late evening walk, and our batteries were very low, and our flashlight managed to walk off a cliff. And I slice open my thumb, so when you hobble back up to the cabin, and you were in bed reading and half asleep, and Elise said that you need some medical assistance, and you got your kit bag out, got some brandy, and I wasn't sure at that point whether that was for you or for me. and got a couple of sutures out, and I think I bit on one of the towels, and you cinched up the end of my thumb. It was a very exciting experience for me. But I like to think that you saved my life. It was very nice. Also, we were out fishing. Do once in a while, and up in the near the pass, I guess there was a Memorial Hot Springs maybe, and we had driven down a trail, and we came back to our cars after day fishing. We discovered that the trail was blocked off by a dump truck that tipped over on the road. We were possibly faced with having to spend the night up there, unprepared to walk through the Memorial Hot Springs and hitch a ride home. The next day, we were able to come back and we had righted this dump truck. We had collected our car. This is, I think that this year probably marks, it marks the 19th year that I've had here. Not quite a lot of my life involved. I certainly enjoy it as well as everyone else in this room. It's kind of hard to remember everybody year to year having a competition distance. I don't see all of you as family. A great treat for us to see you all here. And also like to mention that we have another birthday in the room that we're chronological is today. It's our daughter Jenny. She's 12 years old today.
Sierras, the Twin Lakes, with Brian over here, and we put our stuff on a DNF pack station, and then we just hiked up from Sacramento to the Twin Lakes. And what I remember most about that trip is the fish that we brought back. Brian and I were off fishing, and we were struggling with depression. And he caught back this 12-inch trout, and made a nice breakfast.
I had your presents.
I'd like to add a couple of childhood memories myself. I have, of course, many. But these two seem to stick with me and keep coming recurring, so they must be important in some way. The first of these involves a canoe. I promised I'd get back to that. And in the old days, of course, this isn't Huntington Lake. Everything seems to revolve around Huntington Lake. And the importance of this place in this family's life just cannot be valued in any concrete terms. It is so inestimable. But in the old days, before that road was put in, the only way you could get to Big Creek was the hard way, and we used to do it that way, as Mother will attest, I'm sure, with fond memories, or maybe not so fond. But we'd have a canoe, and we'd get in down at Huckleberry Creek and paddle all the way down to Big Creek. and get off and walk up to into the pools and enjoy a picnic lunch and so forth, and then walk right back down, get in the canoe, and paddle back. Of course, late in the afternoon is when the wind comes up, and the wind is in the wrong direction. So father and mother would be sitting there struggling the 2.5 miles or so it was to paddle from Big Creek back to Huckleberry. And on this particular day, it was very windy and extremely difficult to control the canoe. For reasons I no longer remember, father had to let us off at the, we all got out, mother and all the kids, and he had to take the canoe back out and turn it around or do something that I do not understand. But in any case, we looked out there a few minutes later and no father, no canoe. Well, they were there, but they were lower on the horizon than they had been a minute earlier. And in fact, the wind had just come and lifted under the canoe and picked it right up, turned it over. So father got it in somehow, sopping wet. We got all the way up. The memory that I have, though, at the end of that day was on the clothesline with a whole string of dollar bills hung up. The other memory I have, I do not know how old I was, but I was very young. Father, this runs in the Gibbons family, a certain penchant for and a love for gadgetry. Not all of us are equally gifted at gadgetry, in this particular case was one that shows the limits of our mastery of such things, but this was a situation where there was a gift involved, a gift from father to son. Although I think at the time this was the kind of gift which is perhaps as much for the giver as for the recipient. This was a small, actually submersible toy submarine. And you took this thing and put it in water and did something to it. I was too young to understand how it worked, but it went under the water and supposedly came back up again. Well, we took this out to Golden Gate Park, to a spot there where we were going to see if this would work. And he put the thing into the water and did whatever you did with it, and it submerged beautifully. And that was that. And he couldn't find it. I mean, it was gone. I mean, we went home without it because we could not find the thing. It just simply it sailed under a rock or something and just completely disappeared. And every time I drive past that place, I sort of look out the window thinking perhaps this is the year that the submarine will have decided it's time to resurface and join back with the human race. So these are two stories that just indicated how much my father put in terms of his effort and energy and love in the children that he cherished so much. We appreciate it. There are two more people on my list to be heard from. Is there anyone else who has something to add before I call on these final two persons very, very close to Father Osmond?
I'm just reminded of a boyhood recollection of Henry's. I wasn't there. But I used to get a little exercise kicking a soccer ball around all by myself in the space behind the small cabin. And one day Henry came out, volunteered to do some goaltending, which he did very well. Stopped every one. And that reminded him of a particular game in which he had played as a boy for your school, I guess. I think you went in as a substitute. And you starred as goalkeeper, stopping everything in sight. That was my recollection of your recollection. Have I got it correct?
Yeah, I think so. They said I was a good goalkeeper.
Very good.
I don't think anybody has more authority in this room now to speak than my dear mother. But I would be full of anticipation to hear what you have to say.
Well, the end.
The anticipation has somewhat dissipated because your darling sister Alice stole my story. No, actually, I have a certain amendment to it, but I do have another one that I think is very typical. But I want to point out that Henry, by and large, is judged to be, by people who don't know him very well, to be a pretty kind of conservative fellow. He's always the gentleman. This is true, and I vouch for that. And my friends who come out from school days and so forth, they all say, oh, he's the perfect gentleman, and he is. And I'll tell you why he proves it in just a minute. But the other one that I thought of is that this, our master of ceremonies, was about 6 weeks old. His father got tired of staying home in the evening and not going out, especially out to the 48th Avenue ski rink on Sunday evening. He says, oh, hell, pardon me. Well, let's take him. So we put him in the basket, and I said, Henry, what is your mother going to say? And so, but we put him in the basket, and out we went, and we skated. It turned out to be children's night. And so, oh, he was cute. He was sitting there in this nice, pudgy little face. And so we went home, and we finally told my mom. She said, oh, my goodness gracious, how can you do such a thing? But she finally did get over it. Now, the point of it is that being married to a Gibbons means that I had to start rearing and raising more Gibbonses. So that makes you extremely very cautious and conscious of all of these responsibilities. So I was very well brought up by dear Mama, whom I really did love very much. And she was a very, very particular lady. And she saw to it that her children did behave, and they were gentlemen. And absolutely, absolutely. Now, the day that Henry decided to empty the garbage from our bedroom window, he was indeed dressed and getting dressed in his wonderful, beautiful underwear. And he went to the window, and he stood over there, and with the basket poised like this, and suddenly down it went. Good morning. That's what he said. Good morning. He didn't say hello. He said, no. Good morning.
The last word before you get to say whatever little there is left to say is from your brother, Walter. And I save this for last. Well, it'll be obvious as soon as you hear it why I save this for last. The following anecdote is taken from the life of Henry Gibbons III and is to be read by his son, known as Hal. He has an inimitable style. Down the Rhine from Mainz to Cologne, 1927. My Uncle Walter has assured me that this episode in my father's life is an accurate and true account of their experience while traveling through Europe on a planned tour arranged for by their grandmother, Mrs. J.C. Noonan. This story begins upon their arrival in Mainz, where a celebration was in progress. Beautiful fireworks were displayed from the bridge over the Rhine. When the loud music subsided, a waiter approached their table set on the terrace, from which all the excitement was visible, to take their order for dinner. Henry spoke a little German. Because of their weekly visits to Miss Bermatt for a German lesson, Henry learned, but Walter didn't. Walter was more interested in the dirty German humor shown in the colored illustrations of Miss Bermatt's comic book. So Henry ordered the dinner. When he was presented with a wine list, he said, Walter, let's get a bottle and divide it between us. Oh, no, said Walter. I'm going to have a bottle of my own, and I'm going to have Chateau Duroy. The waiter didn't need an interpretation of this and made a note on his pad. You can't drink a liter all by yourself. Oh, yes, I can, says Walter. Well, if you can, so can I, says Henry, and ordered another bottle. Having had little experience with strong drink, it being prohibition in the United States, the results could have been disastrous, and were. After dinner and the wine, Henry and Walter both agreed with the waiter that an after-dinner liqueur was necessary, so that's what they had. Not just one, but three. Then, arm in arm, they stumbled out and decided to explore the town. At the first street corner, loud music and raucous singing sounded interesting, so they went in. found an empty table, sat down, and ordered steins of beer. In the center of the table was a pile of paper discs from which the waiter took one for each boy and placed it under the foaming stein to catch the drip. After a couple of deep drags on the beer, Walter, for something to do, picked up one of the discs and sailed it out over the crowd. Hey, that's fun, Henry, you try one. Soon, only a few discs remained. I don't think they like this very much. We'd better quit, said Henry, as he pitched his last disc. That did it. It hit the waiter in the face. Immediately, two or three guests came over and grabbed Henry and Walter and threw them out. When outside, Walter noticed that he had forgot his hat. We'll have to go back and get it. Oh, no, we won't, said Henry. But Walter said, I'm not going to let any lousy German keep my new hat. And started back in. Henry, knowing there'd be trouble, left his glasses on a brick windowsill on the right side of the entrance and followed Walter in. As they got well inside, the revelers were waiting for them and gave them a rush to the door, but as the door opened in, they couldn't get out. Just then, the door was pushed in from the outside and three policemen walked in. The shoving continued with those inside trying to push the boys out and the police pushing in to see what was the matter. A general melee followed, with the boys kicking and shoving and swinging their fists. The police grabbed the boys and escorted them roughly into their police wagon, but not before Walter had hit the waiter in the eye and Henry kicked a few shins and somehow happened to break the glass in the door. The wagon was full of drunks, and Walter said, Henry, what did you have to kick the glass and break it for? Henry said, oh, shut up. They were dumped into a wooden bench, and Henry said, we're in big trouble. We're going to be kept here until 10 o'clock this morning when we will be taken before the judge. We will have missed our boat and may not get out of here for a few days. When morning came, they were taken to a washroom to clean up. It seemed a long wait for 10 o'clock. Then about 10:30, they were escorted to the judge's chambers. On the way, Henry said, for once, Walter, keep your mouth shut. These Germans can understand enough English to catch any derogatory remarks you may make. I'm going to try and get us out of here as soon as possible, so don't spoil our chances. Henry did well, and we were released with some admonitions regarding their conduct and $20 American. When outside, we began our search for Henry's glasses. Without them, he would be most uncomfortable. They didn't have much confidence, but after going up and down several streets, they came to the corner saloon, and lo and behold, there were the glasses where they'd been left. We got our train and continued our trip down the Rhine, sleeping most of the way. The scenery was beautiful, I've been told.
Thing I want to do now tonight is to say to Marjorie, happy birthday to you.
Thank you, Henry. Happy birthday to you.
And I know that Jennifer has already said happy birthday to you. I think this party I've been looking forward to like a two-year-old. I'm very excited. And it was wonderful for my immediate family, along with Peggy, to share in this lovely party. I think at the moment I don't know how I can acknowledge and return such a beautiful party, except to wish that all of you are as well as I when they become 80 and beyond. We are lucky in this country to be able to celebrate Thanksgiving and my birthday, I can certainly believe, I'm reminded, let's go back and think of Thanksgiving, how it used to be when the Pilgrims were here. They had their first Thanksgiving, as you know, after they had lived through a hard winter and half of their people had died, and they got together with the Indians and cooked up a Thanksgiving dinner. They had brought over seed to plant, to grow and cultivate so that they could have some harvest, something to eat. But all of their seed had failed to grow. But the Indians had corn that they told them about. And so at this Thanksgiving dinner, besides the cabbage and the wild game that they had, at each one of the Pilgrims' place, they had 6 kernels of corn. They used these kernels to plant corn and grow for their harvest in the ensuing years. Another thought I'd like to bring up, how fortunate we are to be American citizens. We have life, we have liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. What other, how few other nations there are, few people in this world who can say they have those privileges. You know what life and liberty is. We talk a lot about the pursuit of happiness. Do we ever find it? Have we found it? What is it? Well, each one of us has our own solution to that. Mine is this. I have found happiness. I found happiness when I married Richard. Well, I have reached the foreboding stage of being an octogenarian. But actually, I prefer to think of myself as 39 and holding.
39 and holding.
If I were to go on, I might make a few comments, like giving you some of my past history, sort of like a view from the top. I can tell you some of the things I've accomplished or done, either professionally or non-professionally, but that wouldn't be too interesting if you're ever interested. When you go to the library, look it up and who's who in California, because I've got into that. Some of the things I like to think of in my experience in the past, stand out in my life quite a bit, was the time when we in California were the face of the possibility of having compulsory health insurance in this state. And Governor Warren, he was about 38, 39. And I was practicing medicine at that time and still am. And Governor Warren had threatened to introduce this bill forcing compulsory health insurance in the citizens of California. Now this is a very attractive bill because people in California had very low interest and they really weren't able to afford medical care. In the effort to combat their needs, Blue Cross had been organized to prepare hospital care plans, and I have served on their board. And Blue Cross also was helped out by the physicians getting together and forming the California Physician Service. And they offered prepared medical care at low premium to everybody with a $3,000 a year or less income. This, we felt, the medical profession, which I took part in, was a good way to reduce the legislators is going to be on as far as this bill, which was being formulated in Governor Warren had threatened to introduce. The leaders of my medical association went to Warren and said, now, we'd like to have you hold up on this bill of compulsory health insurance before you introduce it. And give us, as a medical profession, a chance to meet and come up with a plan that we think would be better. And Warren, remember this, Warren promised not to introduce it until he heard what the medical profession wanted. The next day, Warren introduced it before the... Now, that was a real threat. Because, now mind you, I'm talking... Because I believe that compulsory health insurance is bad medicine for this state. So, only doctors felt that way. And Warren was a very popular person. Every bill that had been introduced, and he favored it in passing. So, everybody said, well, this has been introduced, Warren's for it, no use fighting it. Well, the medical profession felt differently about it. They got together and they hired a public relations man by the name of Whittaker and Baxter, and they went all out to fight this compulsory health insurance plan. And when the final vote came out, it was defeated by one vote. And the legislators, had it not been for the California Physician Service, they would have won. Begin the physician service headed up first with Ray Lyman Wilmer and his son, I mean not his son, and my grandfather, my uncle, Dr. Morton Gibbons, Peggy's father, became the next head of California Physician Service, and he's been going ever since. He was succeeded by Dr. Sweet Larson, a paid man. Martin had been volunteer. That is an incident in my career that I think stand up being is very important. I had another one in mind. Let's see. Oh yeah, of course. Most of you here are not old enough to know its history, but I was part of Pearl Harbor. I was busy that day, Sunday, December the 7th, 1941, making house calls, and I was hurrying to finish so I could go to a cocktail party that my friend was having that afternoon. And I went into a patient's house, and as soon as they opened the door, he said, what do you think of the news about Camp M? Well, I hadn't had the radio on, so I said, well, I don't know. I hope the Japanese ambassador and our ambassador can come to some agreement. He said, well, haven't you heard? Pearl Harbor has been bombed. Wow. Now, that immediately alerted me because I had been organizing a medical emergency program through the Red Cross last week, which we had set up 12 first aid stations around the city, and I had ordered all the medical supplies, and they were down in the warehouse ready to be distributed. So I immediately canceled what I was doing, and I went down with the help of my other associates. We spent that night distributing all the first aid material to the various 12 cities, because prior to that time, the hospitals hadn't been interested. They didn't think about the emergency. But we felt there might be. And of course, after Pearl Harbor, the lake was destroyed, the coast was defenseless. We didn't know whether the Japs would just keep on coming and invading the coast. So we had blackouts and alerts, and we got ourselves prepared for emergency medical care should we need it. And that was always a vivid memory in my mind, getting around and putting out first aid. And they say, of course, sometimes things don't happen when you're prepared. Well, we were prepared. Some of my friends are talking about family. With the members of my family, Sal and Louise and Alice, I was a delegate to the American Medical Association. We went back east a few times, and we had a chance to go with me when I went to the meetings. And while we were there, we did a little sightseeing, like going to the New York Fair or going to Washington, the Washington Monument. And one time we even took off and went down Montgomery and visited Virginia's brother and his family. And that was a memorable incident. And a number of other experiences that I enjoyed with my family besides spending the lake was like taking a trip in a trailer up the Redwood Highway, up to Victoria and across to Vancouver and down. That was a nice experience. We have really had some good times together. So as I look now and realize what an interesting time I have had, an enjoyable time, I say to you, today, this season, is a day of all days. And I was there. God bless you all. I love you.
Now, no funny faces, James.
All right. Well, good one. So, you got a tired baby, huh?
Indeed. How's it know to bounce the stuff off of her and focus on her rather than the wall back there?
Remember for a second here.
It does that, doesn't it?
Oh, I'm gonna get a little hair right there. That's my other boy.
Oh boy, those chocolate things.
No, thank you.
It's not.
Okay.
Takes pictures, not the sound. It doesn't take
an audio too.
He's got everything you just said on tape. We're about to turn it.
Yeah, it's probably.
Yeah, I think you've got.